Good morning, and welcome to worship here at Buxton United Methodist Church. We are so glad that you're here with us for worship this morning. Let's take a look at our morning announcements. First and foremost, do we have any celebrations today? Birthdays or anniversaries that we want to lift up? Quiet week. Maybe you all haven't recovered from your 4th of July fireworks or something. Okay, well then let's move right along and see. Fellowship will be following worship today. Go ahead and downstairs, and the ladies have prepared many good things. This Monday night, the United Methodist Women's Summer Barbecue, that will be at Flossie's house, and is it 6 or 6:30?
6.
6 o'clock, and Flossie would love it if she could have a little head count. So if you are going, please let her know. Okay. All right, starting tomorrow, it's finally here. Our summertime preschool playgroup. Pause to see if you can help. I think we actually have filled all that up, but please, please pray. I just hope the kids are there. That's all I'm hoping and praying. So pray hard that the kids will come, and we'll look forward to some fun activities together, as well as linking those to Bible verses and lessons. So, save the date. Next week is our 220th birthday celebration. So we're going to have a good time. We actually have a few people who will be joining the church on our birthday, which is exciting. So, please remember to save your recycling. Don't worry if you forgot to bring it, because it'll be going all summer long, okay? But we are saving things for Metro. And today will be the beginning of our summer sermon series, God's Happy Campus. So I'm very excited for that. All right, then let's prepare our hearts for worship with the ringing of the bell, the prelude, and lighting of candles.
Oh no, I'm not offering it. You're going to help me.
out of breath.
I don't want to hurt you.
All right, the next one is a little more familiar. I shall not be moved. So let's go ahead. I'll bet everybody can sing on that one.
I shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the Egyptians chased them. There were chariots and men on horses,
So the people asked me, the Lord, for help, and I caused great trouble to come to the Egyptians. I caused the sea to cover over them. You yourselves saw what I did to the army of Egypt. After that, you lived in the desert for a long, long time. Then I brought you to the land of the Amorites. This was east of the Jordan River. They fought against you, but I gave you the power to defeat them. I destroyed them before you. Then you took control of that land. But the king of Moab, Balak, son of Zippor, prepared to fight against the Israelites. The king sent for Balaam, son of Beor, to curse you. But the Lord refused to listen to Balaam, so he asked for good things to happen to you. He blessed you many times. I saved you and brought you out of his power. Then you traveled across the Jordan River and came to Jericho. The people in the city of Jericho fought against you. Also the Amorites, Perizzites, Canaanites, Hittites, Girgashites, Hivites, and Jebusites fought against you. But I allowed you to defeat them all. While your army traveled forward, I sent hornets ahead of them. These hornets made the people leave before you came. So you took the land without using your swords and bows. It was I, the Lord, who gave you that land. I gave you land where you did not have to work. I gave you cities that you did not have to build. And now you live in that land and in those cities. You eat from the vineyards and all the olive trees, but you did not have to plant them. Then Joshua spoke to the people. He said, "Now you have heard the Lord's words, so you must respect the Lord and serve him fully and sincerely. Throw away the false gods that your people have worshipped." That happened on the other side of the Euphrates River and in Egypt. Now you must serve the Lord every day. But maybe you don't want to serve the Lord. You must choose for yourselves today what you want. You must decide whom you will serve. You may serve the gods that your people worshipped when they lived on the other side of the Euphrates River, or you may serve the gods of the Amorites who lived in this land. As for me and my family, we will serve the Lord. Thank you. And then this scripture, the following one, is from Revelations 3, 14 through 22. This is to the church of Laodicea. Write this to the angel of the church. The Amen is the one who is the faithful and true witness. He is the ruler of all that God has made. He sent this to you. I know what you do. You are not hot or cold. I wish that you were not hot or cold, but you are only warm. I wish you were hot or cold, but you are only warm, not hot, not cold. So I am ready to spit you out of my mouth. You say you are rich. You think you have become wealthy and do not need anything, but you do not know that you are really miserable. You're pitiful, you're poor, you're blind, and you're naked. I advise you to buy gold from me, gold made pure in fire. Then you can be truly rich. Buy from me clothes that are white. Then you can cover your shameful nakedness. Buy from me medicine to put on your eyes. Then you will truly be able to see. I correct and punish those whom I love, so be eager to do right. Change your hearts and lives. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with them, and he will eat with me. He who wins the victory will sit with me on my throne. It was the same with me. I won the victory and sat down with my Father on his throne. Everyone who has ears shall listen to what the Spirit says, and it's said to the churches. Thank you. And now we're going to be blessed with Betsy singing.
Thank you.
And now if all who are able, please stand for the reading of the gospel. And it is John 3:1-17, one of my favorite stories of all. Jesus and Nicodemus. There was a man named Nicodemus who was one of the Pharisees. He was an important Jewish leader. One night, Nicodemus came to see Jesus. You notice he came at night. He said, "Teacher, we know that you are a teacher sent from God. No one can do the miracles you do unless God is in him." Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth. Unless one is born again, he cannot be in God's kingdom." Nicodemus said, "But if a man is already old, how can he be born again? He cannot enter his mother's body again, so how can he be born the second time?" But Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth. Unless one is born from water and the Spirit, he cannot enter God's kingdom. A person's body is born from his human parents, but a person's spiritual life is born from the Spirit. Don't be surprised when I tell you, you must all be born again. The wind blows where it wants to go. You hear the wind blow, but you don't know where the wind comes from, or you don't know where it is going. It is the same with every person who is born from the Holy Spirit." Nicodemus asked, "How can all this be possible?" Jesus said, "You are an important teacher in Israel, but you still don't understand these things. I tell you the truth. We talk about what we know. We tell about what we have seen, but you don't accept what we tell you. I have told you about things here on earth, but you do not believe me. So surely you will not believe me if I tell you about the things of heaven. The only one who has ever gone up to heaven is the one who came down from heaven, the Son of Man. Moses lifted up the snake in the desert. It is the same with the Son of Man. The Son of Man must be lifted up too. Then everyone who believes in him can have eternal life. But God so loved the world so much that he gave his only Son. God gave his Son so that whoever believes in him need not be lost, but have eternal life. God did not send his Son into the world to judge the world guiltily, but to save the world through him." And all who believe, please say, "Amen."
Amen.
You may be seated.
No, it's him.
Oh,
we're
going to sing. Oh,
sorry. Keep standing up. Just trying to catch you before you get up.
Oh, yeah. 389. Yep. And you hear Miller up here on the screen. Thanks.
Thank you.
sight. Oh God, our strength and our Redeemer. I'm going to let you just look in that picture for just a second. God's Happy Campers is what our sermon series is. Don't they all look happy? We're going to have a great time this summer with this. And today's topic is called Choosing Your Destination. We are in this season of summer now, even though we've had precious few days that even resemble summer. But we are in summer. And many people take vacations in the summertime. So that begs the question, when you're going to take a vacation, how do you choose your destination? Well, I think we all would have different answers to that. Some of us would say we go on vacation to places where family and friends live in order to see the people we love and spend time with them. Some of us may choose a particular type of vacation, such as a tour package or even a cruise. I'm thinking of our sweet Sharon, who went to Ireland once on a tour package, right? That must have been wonderful. And I believe our Jean and Sean recently went on a cruise just this past year, right? Yeah. Any other people who have done either of those things, cruise or tour package? All right. Wow. Very good. Some may combine an already scheduled trip for work with a vacation, since the travel cost is already covered. And some may not choose any vacation until they know how much money they have, and that determines where they go. We've probably been in all of those situations. No matter which describes each one of us here today, we all share in common that we must choose a destination if we're going on vacation. There's a process for that, and it's an active choice. I have a fantastic story for you today about choosing one's travel destination and how it can be life-changing. This is a true story. There was a young woman in college whom I will protect the name of. This young lady was 20 years old and was a foreign exchange student studying in Germany. As a foreign exchange student, she wanted to do as much traveling as she possibly could in her year abroad. We understand that, don't we? If you have that year where you're over in Europe, you might as well take advantage of it. Being in Europe, this was especially easy because you really can cross borders anywhere within the European Union quite easily now. She had a friend from home who was also a foreign exchange student, only that young lady was in France. Well, her friend suggested that since they both had a schedule in which their last class was on a Thursday afternoon, why not go somewhere and meet there for the weekend? So they could take a bus, a train, a flight, whatever. They decided on Venice, Italy. That was where they were going to go. Sounds like a good spot to me. I said to you, but yeah, it does sound like fun. So they went online and they each booked their trip, and they were going to meet at a particular location in Venice at 10 a.m. Now here's the thing. One gal's French was better than the other gal's German. So the exchange student from France did in fact go to Venice. But the gal studying in Germany, she ended up instead booking her destination not to Venice, Italy, but to Verona, Italy. Okay? So she's in the wrong city. Both begin have some similar letters. You can see how this happened if she was doing this all. Yeah. Now, I'm not sure how much you know about Italy, but we all know that Venice and Verona are not the same place. this little bit of information, I think, will be helpful to you all. Venice, of course, is the place with all the canals, and the men wear the striped shirts as they row you about with that pole that they use, you know, getting you from place to place along the canals. I always thought it looked fun to do that. I haven't ever done it, but it looks fun. Whereas Verona, that's an often hidden gem of a city in Italy. Anybody ever heard of Verona? Ever been to Verona? You've heard of it, but you don't know a lot about it. You've heard of it. Okay, good. Well, it's a real hidden gem. There's an actual Roman Colosseum there and a very unique tourist attraction as well. You see, Shakespeare based his characters of Romeo and Juliet from one particular spot in Verona.
Jean is shaking her head. She knows.
Yeah. So many people visit this courtyard with the balcony where Juliet famously stood when she and Romeo fell in love. Okay? It's a very romantic spot. In fact, many heartbroken women to this day go and put little notes into the cracks of the wall there. It's called Letters to Juliet. And there are a group of women in the city of Verona who actually respond daily to those letters. It's true. It's called Letters to Juliet. This is true. I'm not making this up. I wouldn't be able to make this up. It is a real big thing in Verona, and it is the number one thing that draws people there. It's what it's known for, to be a spot for people who are either heartbroken and want love or are falling in love. Okay. Now, did I mention that this particular event happened on Valentine's Day weekend? Yeah, it's getting better, isn't it? So not knowing what to do, finding herself in the wrong city, realizing there were no canals, she had a good inkling that she had booked her flight to the wrong place. So she decided to find some place to eat because she was a bit hungry. She was stressed and upset. What to do? What should she do to get herself out of this predicament? So she sat down at a lovely outdoor cafe and ordered immediately a coffee with a tiramisu, because everything always looks better after a wonderful Italian dessert. Her young, rather handsome waiter, he was wide-eyed, said something was wrong for any woman to order that at 10 a.m. And he happened to be able to speak some English, which was her native language. She told him her predicament and that she didn't know what she was going to do. So she might as well eat tiramisu.
And Lynn says, that's right.
So she told him, and her kind waiter told her it would be in the house. And that if she could just wait there for about a half an hour, he would be getting off work at 11. He'd gladly call his mother and have her come to help. So the young lady, not knowing what to do, happily agreed. And that sweet young man paid the bill for her. Well, long story short, Italian mama showed up. Oh, Italian mama was so happy to see the younger lady. And she just started loving her to pieces. Now, she didn't speak a word of English, and our young traveler didn't speak any Italian, but that didn't seem to matter. Italian mama kept carrying on and hugging her and saying, Bella donna, casa famiglia, and amore. You get the gist of it, right? Yeah, Italian mama was welcoming her into the family and clearly hoped she and her son would fall in love. Which they did. Now, Italian mama and family took the girl in for the weekend, and the wonderful son took her all over Verona, showing her all of the sights. They fell in love right below Juliet's balcony. This was the first of many trips that year to Verona. And by the end of the school year, they were engaged. So quite literally, choosing her destination that one day in late September, it truly changed her life. It was a life-changing event. Now I want to jump to the Christian life. The Christian life is similar to planning a vacation. When one makes the decision to ask Jesus to forgive our sins and come reside in our hearts, it is a life-changing decision, and it changes the destination of our entire trip in this life. We are all getting a ticket to paradise. And as the old spiritual song lyrics explain, get on board, children, get on board. And it is a bit like having a train ticket. But holding the ticket in our hands is not enough. We need to take action. We have to literally move in order to get on board. And the last stop of that train is even better than Verona. It's paradise. I want to go to our gospel lesson now. Nicodemus, as Lynn told us, came at night to see Jesus. Why did he come at night? Probably because he was trying to keep a low profile, but I love it that he came at night. Nicodemus came to see Jesus at night, and the woman at the well came to see him in the middle of the day. That shows us that it doesn't matter what time of day or night we come to Jesus. What matters is that we simply come. Our Lord is available to us 24 hours a day. Day, night, it doesn't matter. So Jesus began explaining to Nicodemus the process of Christian decision-making, or, as we're saying for our sermon series, choosing our destination. He tells Nicodemus that he must be born again. Now, Nicodemus had no idea what he was talking about. He had no idea he was talking about choosing a destination or a ticket to paradise. And in truth, we all, given the same situation, probably would have been in the same predicament, very confused. How can one, as an adult, shrink down and climb back inside the womb to be born once more? Asked Nicodemus. But what Jesus was trying to teach Nicodemus was that the action that one takes in choosing one's destination, one's ticket to paradise, it's an active decision we all need to make to say a yes or a no. Do we say yes to Christ's gracious invitation to forgive us our sins and come into our hearts to stay and to lead us in our daily living? Or do we say no? My friends, this is a life-changing decision. Choosing this destination is even more life-changing than our young foreign exchange student who found herself in the wrong place at the right time, and it changed her life forever by meeting her husband. She found love because of her choice of destination. But we find a far greater love with ours. When we choose Jesus, we choose the greatest love ever known. We choose amazing grace
choose mercy. We choose compassion. We choose a lifetime of never being alone. And we choose the destination of paradise on the gospel train. The Beatles once had a song called She's Got a Ticket to Ride. Remember that one? She's got a ticket to ride. Well, I'm sure it wasn't about the gospel train, but that's what I'm using it for. Because this girl knows she's got a ticket to ride. Let's all get a ticket to ride the gospel train, where the final destination will be paradise. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. It's time to come before the Lord in prayer. And we'll have a time of sharing our, lifting up our the names of people and places and situations. And I remind you that because it's recorded and goes online, we use first names only. Let's go before our God. Oh, Lord God, we thank you so much for your Son, Jesus Christ, who came to earth to love us and give us the love, offer us the greatest love ever, ever known. We say yes, 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 Lord. We thank you that we've got a ticket to ride that gospel train that one day, after a lifetime of service, will bring us to paradise. Lord, we come before you this week and we take a few moments to thank you for the many joys and good things that have happened. So we take a few moments now to lift up our joys for you.
Thanks, 90th birthday
party. The Anderson family finally getting a vacation after many years. Things that were spoken and the others that remain in our hearts and minds, we say, Lord, hear our praise. And now we come before you lifting up the concerns that we have for the people, places, and situations in our community, in our nation, in our world. And we lay them before you now as in our concerns.
Amen.
The mass shootings that have happened over the holiday weekend when people were trying to celebrate our nation's birthday. For all these things, Lord, that have been spoken and those that remain silent in our hearts and minds, we say, Lord, hear our prayer. And we pray now together the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven,
to thank you for the many ways that you have supported the life of our congregation in the giving of your time, your talents, and your treasure. And we remind you that there is an offering plate in the back on top of the table. And now it's time for our final hymn, which is just a little brief one, but is it, how many verses is it? Linda, I don't have
two.
Just two. It's going to make us end a little early, my apologies, but it's such a beautiful, beautiful.
beautiful song. Please stand in your ear and sing, "You Touched Me," 367, either on the screen or in your head.
She doesn't get it.